Okay, so welcome to ARC again, and this week we are back to our main track, 1 Peter 2. Today it's verses 11 to 17. So before we start, I'll pray, because this morning is a weird morning. You know, some mornings you get up and you just know that something's different. It's a weird morning. And when I was having my shower, God met with me in prayer and made me realize that I was getting really down, praying for a whole lot of people that just seem hopeless. Really hopeless. Like you want to bang their heads on the wall, you know, to wake it, and they just seems hopeless, and you think, what's the point of even still praying? And that's, for me, that's really depressing, because the only thing that keeps me going in this world is the hope of other people's salvation. I'm not self-motivated. Your salvation matters to me more than my own. And I can only think of myself as wanting to be in heaven if you are there. That's how it is for me. So even these people, it's the same for me. You know, heaven will be not happy for me if those people are missing, because they're a burden to me. So what did God say to me in the shower this morning? You know, when you're in intercession, you feel like you're trying to convince God to care. You're trying to convince God to do something with these stubborn people, to do something with these people that are not taking him seriously, to do something, as if he doesn't really want to, but you're trying to convince him to do it right. So what did God tell me this morning? He told me to just pray with thanksgiving, that the very reason, listen carefully, that the very reason they are so heavy to me is because he is the author of that. That it's him trying to convince me to care about them. That he already cares about them. That he already wants to save them. That I don't have to convince him to want to save them. That he wants to save them more than I do. That he's sharing that burden with me. And why does it hurt so much? Because it hurts him so much. Why does it seem so hopeless? Because he wants me to understand that apart from him, they will perish. That there's nothing I can do that will be enough. There's nothing you can do that will be enough. That unless Jesus saves you, you will not be saved. No one, remember, all have sinned, all have fallen short. So I want to pray, and because that sort of ties in with what our message is today, unsurprisingly, I guess. So Father, we thank you, we bless you, that you are intent on saving as many as can be saved, that even those people, Lord, that you had me pray with you this morning, as hopeless as they seem, as impossible to reach as they seem, as completely overwhelmed with pride and arrogance and enslaved by other people's flattery as they seem. And those people, Lord, they are everywhere in the world. That you have said, what is not possible for man is possible for God. Nothing is too hard for you, least of all to keep your promises, to keep your covenant, to uphold your own shame, to do yourself by your own right hand, by the breath of your mouth. As you said to Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. What we cannot do, you can. So Lord, as we turn to our topic today, the topic of submitting to earthly authorities, the command you gave, which can seem a similar, hopeless and futile thing, Lord, we pray that you will really write in us, engrave in us, Lord, deeply understanding, not just knowledge, but understanding and wisdom, and empower us by your Spirit to obey these things, especially in the days ahead. We pray this for those who are here and those who will hear this later. We pray this, Lord, in your name, for your purpose and for your glory. Amen. Amen. So you'll see our picture this morning. Does that look okay, Jess? Can you see that? So our actual, obviously we're back in 1 Peter 2, but our picture this morning comes to us from Matthew 26, verse 52. So this is when Jesus is being arrested. His disciples are there. What's the initial reaction when his disciples see that the guard of the Sanhedrin, that the temple guard have come to arrest him? What do they do? Is it passive or violent? What's the first reaction of the disciples? I'll give you a clue. It involves somebody's ear. That's right. The first instinct is to stop it happening. So one of them pulls out his sword and chops off the ear of one of those sent to arrest him, right? Remember that. That's a big theme today, that the human instinctive reaction is to try and use our strength to stop what we don't want to happen, because we are relying on our thinking, not God's. Well, I think it's Daryl, isn't it? Isn't it your favorite scripture? How's it go? Lean not upon your own understanding, but trust in him. What does God say? For my thoughts and my ways are higher than your ways. As high as the heavens are above the earth, so high are my thoughts above yours. Never assume that God is instructed by your thoughts. You know, when you're tempted to lecture God about what should happen, and if that never happens to you, you're not human. You know, that's a normal human thing. We're forever lecturing God about what we think should happen. Sometimes that's led by the Spirit and he answers, but oftentimes that's us grabbing our sword and chopping off someone's ear because we're trying to stop something that God himself has required to happen. Did Jesus need to be arrested for the scripture to be fulfilled? Yes. Could you be saved if he hadn't been arrested? No. He had to be arrested. He had to be falsely accused. He has to go to the cross. He has to die and rise from the dead for you to have any hope of going to heaven. What we'll see today is there's a lot of stuff like that ahead of us. That's history behind us, right? But there's a lot of that ahead of us, and we need to know how to deal with it. So look at the picture, and let's just read. So we're just going to read verses 52 to 54 there. So Jesus responds. So the guy's chopped his ear off, had his ear chopped off, and Jesus leaps up and he says, "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him. "For all who draw the sword will die by the sword." All who draw the sword will die by the sword. If you insist on trying to fix things by human effort, by human means, to human standards, the end of that will not be salvation. That's what he's saying. And, of course, they're concerned for him, right? They're thinking, but you know, you're my rabbi. We can't let them arrest you. What does Jesus say in verse 53? It says, "Do you think I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled which say it must happen this way?" It must happen this way. You'll see I've put a note there. His power was revealed by what God did with his obedience. God did not give his son signs and wonders and have... Does anyone know how many 12 legions of angels is? 72,000. Guess how many Roman soldiers were in Jerusalem at the time of the crucifixion? are around 600. So you've got a garrison of 600 Romans faced off against 72,000 angels of the heavenly host, supernatural beings. So if you like those Marvel comics, be like 600 cops facing 72,000 of whichever the bad guy version, because I don't watch those movies. You know what I mean, right? You'd say, oh, the history. Well, that's right. That's what Jesus is saying. If I needed saving, if I needed to be out of here, if I needed to not be arrested, do you think I can't rescue myself? Do you think I can't call on my Father and he would surround me with 72,000 angels? How many angels do you think it takes to defeat every Roman soldier in Jerusalem? Right? So this is the point Jesus is making. He would only need one to come to his aid. God could send him 72,000. So he's saying to his disciples, put your thinking away. Put your assuming away. You assume I need rescuing from this event that you don't like, that's unpleasant for you. You would rather it didn't happen. But see what he said at the end? But look, it has to happen. Scripture must be fulfilled. Because you know what? If it doesn't happen, I can't save you. Right? The same reason he says, no one takes my life from me. I lay it down and I'll take it up again. No one forced Jesus to be crucified. Who crucified Jesus? Jesus. I lay my own life down and I will also take it up, right? It's the same thing. It had to happen. No, but the human reaction, and we have the same today when bad stuff happens, we rush in, swords drawn, thinking that our job is to stop it, without wondering, is this something that has to happen in God's order for God's word to be fulfilled? So our most recent example, and we're not going to talk about vaccines before anyone gets worried. So my position on vaccines stays exactly as it ever was. If you want to be vaccinated like me, get the vaccine. If you don't want to, don't. That's your choice. It's just a medical issue. If you think you should have it, have it. If you don't think you should have it, don't have it. It's a medical decision. That's it. It's got nothing at all to do with salvation. Zero. Zero. Right? But remember what happened when the government said to certain groups of people, like police and soldiers and nurses and doctors, I think there's some more, I can't remember, but that you couldn't work. You were compelled to have it. And there was a huge debate blew up in the Christian community about whether to comply with what was seen as a big overstep of power, that these politicians had gone too far, forcing people to have a vaccine and saying you can't have your job unless you... And they were obviously thinking about the mark of the beast, right? And some people were even silly enough to start equating the vaccine with the mark of the beast. Just, it's the whole topic in itself, but scripturally just utter nonsense, right? Utter nonsense. But people started squabbling with each other and fighting each other, you know, and injuring each other in the Christian community over whether it is right to submit to a secular authority, the government. And the thing I would hear most often, I don't know if any of you had this experience, but the argument they made most often is, oh yes, we should be obedient, we should be good citizens, unless. And then the unless was, unless we think that the instruction is evil, that it doesn't suit me, you know. So they made, just on the seat there. So they were saying there's an exception. So we think what the government have asked is evil. We don't think it's of God, blah, blah, blah. So they were counseling people to rebel, to act in a rebellious way against the civil authority, and refuse. So our question today is to forget about the vaccines themselves and all that. We want to know what does God's word say? How do you decide whether you need to submit to that secular authority or not? What does God's word actually say about that? Because the closer we get to the end, the more, which side of the good versus evil is going to start to have more and more influence and control in the world the closer you come to the end? Evil. The peak of which is what? Antichrist, right? So it will go from bad to worse. As Jesus said, they will go on deceiving and being deceived. Everything will go from bad to worse until the end. The peak of it, of course, is the literal seven-year reign of Antichrist, where good will seem to have completely left the planet altogether, right? This will already tell you what part of the motivation of people who don't like this instruction is. The same people that don't like it tend to be NAR-type people, Kingdom Now people, who still have a delusion in their head that there's going to be an end times revival, like the whole world will end up Christian and then Jesus will come. That's a complete opposite of what Scripture says. But if you're caught in that lie, and that whole dominionist world, which includes New Apostolic Reformation and a bunch of other stuff, that's a fundamental belief. So that's why they're always praying for revival, because in their heads, if they just praise enough, you know, sing your praise songs loud enough and often enough, and if you just flatter God by telling him how cool he is, just a side note, why does God want you to praise him? Because he does want you to praise him. It's from the Old Testament. See if anyone can get it. What is praise a medicine for? I'll give you a clue. In the Old Testament, it's referred to a garment. What is a garment? It's something you put on, right? So something external that you put on for an occasion. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. Praise to God is not for God's benefit. Praise to God is a balancing, it's a medicine against a spirit of despair, a spirit of heaviness. How does it work? When you're in despair and when you're feeling heavy, at the same time you start to forget who God is. You're not seeing him and as who he really is. You start to think of him as, oh, these days, you might make the mistake of thinking that he's like the church. And since the church is so corrupt, the church doesn't keep its promises. The church tells you it'll do things and then it doesn't. Tells you that it'll love you, then it doesn't. You know, tells you that you're a family and then it treats you like a stranger, etc., etc. So for lots of people, when they get into the heaviness, if their picture of God is dominated by how bad church has been to them, it's very, very easy for them to go under. So God's prescription is that you should praise him for who he really is. Things like, thank you that for as many as are the promises of God, they are yes and amen in Christ unconditionally. If God has promised it, it will be. Whatever has proceeded from his mouth, he watches over to see to it that it is accomplished. Totally opposite of the church. Totally opposite of a bunch of corrupt priests. God himself. Don't praise the church. Don't praise any pastor. Don't praise any guy in a shiny suit. God. Right? But they have twisted it to think that they can somehow stop. Remember what we said about, you know, they rush and chop the servant's ear off? Because in their estimation, what should happen is not what God says is going to happen. For them, what should happen, they've had a better idea than God's idea. If we just praise enough, if we just praise God and lift his ego, because that's what they're doing. They're trying to flatter God into stopping what's happening and having worldwide revival instead. Question for you. If worldwide revival was possible, what would God have to do to get people into the revival? The wicked who are not listening to him now. What would he have to do? Sorry? He'd have to change their free will. And if they believe that their love of sin and their hedonistic way that they're living now, if they believe that that's best and that's good and right for them, and God knows it's not, it's the reason they're going to go to hell, what would he have to do to them to save them? This is really important to today. What's he going to do to the stubborn Jews, to Jacob, in the time of Jacob's trouble, to save as many as he can of them? What's he going to do? The tribulation. He's going to put them through terror. What does the terror do? It destroys the illusion that what they have relied on is enough. It destroys the illusion that they are okay already, that they don't need a savior. But that's not what Kingdom Now people want. That terrifies them. That's what they're trying to avoid. They want some kind of mystical experience where everyone's suddenly running around as if they're on amphetamines or something. No. There is a kind of revival at the end, but it looks nothing like what they're praying for. It's called the tribulation. We've done this before, and it's in these notes, but it doesn't matter if it's out of order. Remember the last church of the seven churches in Revelation, Laodicea? Laodike in Greek means the people's opinion. What do you see now? The people treat, even in the church, do they treat the word of God as an absolute that can't be edited? No. All these churches are editing the word of God to suit the majority view. The people's opinion starts to have more weight than the word itself. We are living in the Laodicean age of the church. So what he says about Laodicea has direct consequence for our age that we live in, especially for the church, right? What's God's complaint? He says, I wish you were either hot or cold, but since you're only lukewarm, you're neither one or the other. You're this awkward, unpleasant mixture. You're sitting on the fence. He says, I can't tolerate that. I'd rather you just left me, or you're really for me, when I can't stand your complacent indecision, your assumption that you're okay without going the whole way, without picking up your cross, sitting there on the fence, lukewarm, which is most of the church. He says, I want to vomit you out of myself. That's how much God hates that. So that's what the tribulation does. It makes it impossible to sit on the fence. It makes it impossible to stay complacent. It forces every soul to decide to be either hot or cold. You're either going to be really absolutely for Jesus or really absolutely not. That's what's actually going to happen. So this dynamic is already happening. All of those Kingdom Now people are rushing, trying to force their version of the end. And they think that by their singing and their carrying on and whatever, and name it and claim it and commanding this and commanding that in Jesus' name, that they can make the outcome what they think it should be. But what will it be? Is it going to be what they think or what God said? It's obvious, right? It's what God said. Keep all that in mind as we look further and go over. So we see that same scripture here again, Matthew 26. But look what, see in the red there. Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching and you did not arrest me." But all this had taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled. The message Jesus was giving them was, everything that's happened and is happening because God has foreseen this is the end. He has spoken through the prophets. He has warned his people in advance so that you will know it when you see it. Does anyone know what Jesus, you know, in Matthew 24, when he's warning about the end times, he says something to comfort them because it's all scary, right? He says, "I'm telling you now." So in other words, all the scary stuff I've told you, he says, "I am telling you now." How does it end? "So that when it happens, you are not overcome." If you know it's what's going to happen, it's not shocking when it does. Have any of you been on one of those insanely scary fairground rides? You know, where you need your head red to get on it? So have you ever ridden it twice? So the first time, because you don't know what's going to happen, they are designed to do the unpredictable, right? So when it's spinning this way and then it suddenly just like stops and goes the other way, you scream because you're not, nothing in you is prepared for it to do that. But if you get back on that ride again straight away, you'll want your money back because it'd be boring. Why? Because now you know what to expect. It's no longer shocking. That's what Jesus was doing. Speaking of vaccines, he was inoculating us. He was giving us the vaccine against being overcome with shock by telling us in advance everything that's going to take place, and that so long as you're his, you will see it for what it is, God's word being fulfilled at his command. Not God losing control, the exact opposite. But note he says, "I'm not leading a rebellion." That's really important as we go on. He's trying to get them to understand that all these things have to happen. They have to happen. The disciples aren't the only ones who are guilty of assuming that Jesus should try and save himself. Who else assumes that? In the same occasion, so he's arrested. What happens next? He's put on trial, right? If you remember from Passover, it's because a lamb has to be examined for defect. So God goes overboard. Normally you just get the priest to examine him. That's what happens when he's before the Sanhedrin. So they're trying to find fault with him. They don't know that they're examining the Passover lamb. They just think they're trying to find something to accuse him, right? But from God's law, they are examining the Passover lamb to see if he has any defect. Did they succeed? No. So what did they do? They sent him to Herod, the secular Jewish leader. So he did the same. What was the deal with Herod? Was he like the Sanhedrin? Was he bursting to find something wrong with Jesus? No. What was Herod's attitude? Just say something. Just admit something. Save yourself. He says that. Save yourself. The Sanhedrin assumed that if he was threatened with death, he would confess that he wasn't the Messiah, right? And they could give him a bit of a beating and boot him out of town or something. But he didn't. But they assumed that that's what he should do. Herod assumed the same. Pontius Pilate assumed the same. Faced with death, they all assumed that the right thing to do was to stop the crucifixion. Right? Why didn't Jesus just compromise then? We just read it. These things must happen so that what is written, what the prophets have spoken by the Lord, must take place. That doesn't just apply then, it applies to everything that's in front of us now. That's the future till the end of human history. God has already spoken about all of it. Everything that must happen, must happen. Even all the things that you see going on in Israel now, her enemies surrounding her, the whole thing, right? That's not an accident. All the anti-Semitism that suddenly sprang up all around the world, how coincidence that it came out of the woodwork everywhere at full throttle all at once. That's not politics, that's spiritual. That's God's word being fulfilled. It's setting the scene for the time of Jacob's trouble. Right? By the way, on the Israeli front, really good news, in case you missed it, the IDF have recovered another 4 hostages alive in Gaza. So, you know, that's awesome. So let's hope that God will give them yet more success, right? But you're getting the point. The human response is stop it, stop it. We must stop it somehow. Because we are selfish. And the problem with humans is we live in the here and now. Who's heard of mindfulness? If you're in government departments, they'll tell you that they'll offer you free courses to go and learn how to practice mindfulness. Does anyone know where mindfulness comes from? It's Buddhism. Okay, it's Buddhist meditation. So it teaches you to empty yourself and just live in the present. Right? Just be mindful of just only now. So that is the opposite of what we are to do. The Holy Spirit tells us to be alert, to be on watch, to know what's coming. Mindfulness is training you to accept the Antichrist. Mindfulness is unbelievably wicked, right? But all of these things are happening everywhere. And you can't stop it because their appearance is, because this is what must happen at the end. So on something like that, what can you do? All you can do is A, don't do it yourself, and B, when you have opportunity, help people to understand that it's not God. It's not God. Anyway, that's for another day. We can talk about that more. So I see there on page 2, like humans today, all of their minds were stuck in this world as if this world was all there was and this life was the only life that was going to be. Which brings us back to Kingdom Now, NAR and all that stuff. What's their fundamental mistake? They think that this is going to be heaven, that it'll be heaven on earth. Whereas what does the scripture say? How does the Bible end? The very last chapter in the book. What does God show John? I saw a new heaven and a new earth without defect, without sin. This is not home. You are strangers in the world. You have to fix your eyes on the destination. This is the wilderness journey. I keep saying this to you, it's true. The whole book of Exodus is a story of this life you're living. This isn't the destination. This is the wilderness journey on the way, which is why it's so hard. Would you willingly choose to go live in the desert with the snakes and the scorpions and have to scratch around for something to eat and dig deep holes for find a drop of water? That's this world, right? But you will encounter this more and more where people will not have heaven in mind. It'll all be about, like mindfulness teachers, just worrying about today. If you only worry about today and never worry about tomorrow, as a society, what will tomorrow look like? Anyone know what's happening in South Korea with the youth? In South Korea, it's very expensive to be married, very expensive to buy a property, and very expensive to have education. So if you have kids, you're up for insane amounts of money, right? So they're not getting married. They're teaching each other, especially the girls, are teaching each other that they should just, like with the mindfulness message, just live for the moment. Have a good job, spend the money on yourself, have your own apartment, go out with your girlfriends, live for now. Why? Because there's no point thinking that there's a future, because you can't afford to have kids, you can't afford. So when they collectively do that, what's happened to South Korea is they now have the lowest birth rate in the world. More people die every day by a significant portion in South Korea than get born. Their population number is going shk. 60% of their population are already old. They will die because there's no youth to replace them. There's no youth to pay their government taxes that the old people are paying at the moment. So they've calculated that their pension fund will run out completely by 2050. So the young know there won't even be a pension. Nothing. So they've given up. They've basically decided to just live for now and then last one out, turn the lights off. So short of a miracle, South Koreans will be extinct in Korea within two generations. They will literally die out and not exist. Of course, before that happens, they'll run out of soldiers young enough to fight sooner and just watch North Korea come racing over the border to take the whole lot for themselves, right? This is what happens when you're not focused on the destination, where you're just living for the here and the now. Same thing's happening in China, incidentally. So we mustn't be like that. We must fix our eye on the prize. We must understand we're in a journey. This is not home. This is not home. This is the way, on the way home. Let's look and see how the scripture describes these people. Philippians 3. Join together in following my example, brothers and sisters, is Paul talking. Just as you have us, meaning the apostles, as a model, keep your eyes on those who live as we do. For as I have often told you before and now tell you again, even with tears, many live as enemies of the cross of Christ. Their destiny is destruction. Their God is their stomach. Their glory is their shame. Their mind is set on earthly things. Let me just translate that for you. They live as enemies of the cross. They will not live a crucified life. They will not put their fleshy desires to death. Instead, their God is their stomach means what they bow down to is what their fallen human nature demands. So they worship themselves. They won't take up the cross. They bow to their own sinful desires, right? What they think is their own glory, from God's perspective, is their shame. If you want to be really successful in the fallen world, what's the best way? Serious question. If you're not a Christian, if you don't want, forget about salvation, if you don't care, if you just want to be super wealthy, popular, blah, 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 big house, all that stuff, what's the best way? Trample over everyone else. Put yourself first. Never mind who else dies in the process. Grab, steal, take. Be a bully. Be a thief. But be a good thief. Don't get caught. Well, that describes most Hollywood people. Most of your music industry people. You know, That's how you succeed, and so that's what Satan blesses. So if you want the biggest house in Satan's sandpit, go for it. That's the way to do it. The problem is, none of that will endure. Remember what it says in Luke? Woe to you, rich. You've already had your reward. When it matters, none of what you have will be of any value. It cannot save you. On the contrary, it'll be the reason you are shut out of heaven. That's what this is saying. Their glory, what they think is their glory, their success, what others praise them for, ought to be their shame. Their success is their failure. When the day of judgment comes, they will find it out too late. Then the killer here, their mind is set on earthly things. They think this is it. They think this life and this place, that's it, right? No clue. But our citizenship is in heaven. This is not home. We eagerly await a Saviour from there, the Lord Jesus Christ, who by the power that enables him to bring everything under his control. How much is everything? Everything. Any exceptions? No. You should memorize this. For when you, if you think Satan's winning, no, he's not. Everything Satan is doing is for God's righteous purpose. Whenever God wants to switch him off, there's no contest. You know, he'll have brought a sharp pointy stick to a gunfight against Jesus. He's dust before the wind. Jesus is supremely sovereign. So he's able to bring everything under his control and will transform our lowly bodies so that they will be like his glorious body. Thanks be to God for a trade-in on this, right? If you're happy with your body, you'll be the only person on the planet. But we're not stuck in this forever. This thing that keeps breaking down doesn't work properly. He will transform our lowly body so that we'll be like his glorious body. When it says glorious body, it means Jesus glorified, right? What does that look like? It tells you in the Bible. They were in the room, and the doors and the windows were locked because they were afraid. And suddenly, he was among them. No one opened the door. In his glorified state, he was still solid. Remember, he gets Thomas, put your finger in my wound, touch me. See, he eats to prove that he's not a ghost. He's not a spirit. He's real, solid. He has a body, right? But he was able to walk through walls. He was able to be in one place and then instantly in another. He could walk on the water. He could do all those things. He showed us a preview of our heavenly bodies. He is the prototype. His body is the prototype for ours. So it's only a tiny preview. We do not know yet what we will be truly like. But he's still in human form. He's still he suddenly doesn't look like, I don't know, an eagle or something. He's still recognizably human, but not like we are now. Not this frail, broken thing. So again, if you like those X-Men movies, if you like the idea of all that, be a Christian. One day in the kingdom, it seems you'll be able to teleport yourself wherever you want. Security might be an issue because all your friends will be able to walk through the wall. You know? Do you understand? In our home, in our final state, it's a whole different thing. A whole different thing. But these people, they don't want any of that. They refuse the cross. They don't want to change. They're all about here and now and this world and what sin offers them. Their success is their failure. Their glory is their shame. They have no regard for God, his prophets, for Jesus or the apostles. They don't care. They don't understand that they are not in control. They don't understand that what they want to happen is not what's going to happen. That's why there's so much distress in the tribulation, because it will demonstrate to them that they are not in charge. And that no matter what they do, it won't matter that they're the majority. It won't matter which politician they vote for. Because it will be God himself that they're fighting. God watching over his word to fulfill it. To fulfill it. That's a whole different ball game. I think we'll shoot over to page 3. There's a little bit more there, but just stuff you can read at home. So, some people, because they see the world getting more and more immoral, more wicked, especially thanks to left-wing politics. If you don't understand why it's left-wing, it's because it's a core tenet of communism and everything that springs from communism, that there is no God. That God and the idea of religion is to oppress the masses. By saying that you should fear God means that's a way of keeping the people fearful so you can control them more easily as a king or a president, right? That's what communism teaches. So communism is constantly trying to cancel religion. So anyone who falls into a left-wing, socialist, liberal state of mind is inclined that way. And you're seeing it in all our societies, right? Where everything that God forbids is suddenly being promoted. And they have no fear of God. Why? Because for them, for the lefties, there's no such thing as God. Why be afraid of something that doesn't exist? That's what they will tell you, right? So they are happily trying to get rid of everything God ever said. If he said you can't do it, they promote it as something that everyone should do, even when it's insane. How many genders are there?
Yeah. Kardashian is now sexually attracted to herself, so she's added two more letters.
But how many genders are there actually? If you're a scientist, two. Just two. Male and female. That's the science. So what do? They edit the meaning of gender. They give gender a new meaning. The new meaning is whatever you feel that you are. And then if you don't fit into any category, that's right, you just make a new one. So no one even knows how many, that's why they say LGBT++ now, because they run out of letters, right? So this plus is like, because no one even knows, is it 70, is it 100, is it 300? Who knows, right? But it's all a delusion. Why, when you see people debating them, doctors, scientists, geneticists, debating them with facts. Why do those people never succeed? Why do those wise men never succeed in changing the mind of those people that are promoting this stuff? This is an important thing to understand. Because you watch and go on YouTube and watch hundreds of people trying to get through. Why is none of it working? Because it's not about the mind, it's spiritual. You can't defeat a demon with a maths lesson. You can't defeat a demonic delusion. If the person is embracing that and unrepentant, that demon has the right to stay. You can talk the truth at them all day long until you're blue in the face. They cannot hear you. They don't have free will. They are, at the very least, oppressed, if not possessed. It's spiritual. Which on the top of page 3, you'll see a reminder, Ephesians 6, verse 12. Our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. So when Jacinda Ardern was in, I tried to pray for her a couple of times. Immediately, the worst spiritual oppression you can imagine came back at me. Like, actually, all my bones started aching. It was like when you pray for a witch, you know? Because the spirit at work in that woman and those people was absolutely demonic. And people say, oh, but she's nice. Oh, yeah, right. So she told all the radio stations after the Christchurch thing that the whole country should stop and listen to the Islamic call to prayer. And all the New Zealand radio stations had to broadcast the Islamic call to prayer. Islam is a demonic religion. Then she tells us all that we have to bow to the pagan gods of the Maoris and changes all the legislation to push the Christian God out and reestablish all the pagan deities. The spirit at work, Jacinda Ardern is not the problem. Like the vaccine thing, people who are constantly saying the problem is the UN or the problem is the World Health Organization, or, you know, they're looking at the earthly thing and they think that's a problem. No, it's not. The problem is the spiritual entity that's pulling their strings. On back of all that stuff is Antichrist. On back of all that stuff is the slow but inevitable traverse towards what will end up as the rule of Antichrist. But all over the world, you've got people trying to confront it with politics. Like in America now, right? They're all voting for Trump to get rid of the crazy lefties who have destroyed American society, destroyed America's economy, and all but wiped the church out and their education system. America is like third world now. Most of the big cities like New York, have you seen the pictures? They're full, their streets are full of squatters like Tondo, you know, on a bad day. There's no police, the police are just quitting, giving up. It's just a nightmare. Los Angeles and, I can't remember the other one, over in California, they're the same. Anyone who's got enough money to leave is leaving those places, getting out of those places. Their society is imploding, right? So they're all rushing to, they think it's political, so they're rushing to Trump to stop it. Well, yeah, he's the least of two evils because he is against all that stuff, right? But he himself is not Christian either. What they're all missing is that you can't stop this. Why is it happening to the States? Anyone like to guess? Why is it so bad there? Ask yourself where most of the apostate teaching in the world church came from. Where did Toronto come from? Where did NAR come from? Where did Purpose Driven come from? Where did Prosperity Gospel come from? Doesn't matter what you say that is a demonic apostate doctrine. It's the USA, the USA, the USA, the USA, the USA. The very worst of the shiny suit boys who are after your money and your soul. What are they? American, 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 American. Right? The apostate church in the US is responsible for most of the damage to Christianity globally. So it's no surprise that God has the entire country under judgment because the church there still is not repenting. Instead, the church has got behind Trump and they think that a political answer is enough. They don't understand. It's God's judgment coming on them. It's God's judgment. What does that make Joe Biden and his lot then? We're going to see that in a second and it might shock you. But for now, understand that because it's God's judgment about a pre-existing apostasy, America, before this happened, America was already gone spiritually. They'd already turned away from God. They'd already turned to all kinds of garbage. So this is God's response to that. Their society isn't imploding because these things have come. It was already imploding. This is God making it clear that what you have chosen is death, not life. Tribulation. If you're sitting on the fence, get off. If you're cold, get hot. Unless you want to just die. What you see happening there is going to be all over the world. Why? It's because God is on back of it. It's demonic, but God sends it. God sends it. For those who think that politics will be enough, let's imagine I've got my special magic wand here, bang, right? And I just ended the UN, ended the World Health Council, I just ended, insert anything you think is really to blame and the problem, you know. Right? They're gone, gone, puff of smoke, gone. What happens next? They all come back. Why? It's what Jeremiah says. You'll see on the top of page 3, Jeremiah 5, verse 30. A horrible and shocking thing has happened in the land. The prophets prophesy lies, and the priests rule by their own authority. And then the bit I highlighted, and my people love it this way. That's what's wrong. Trump might be able to get rid of a bunch of crooked politicians, but he can't fix what's actually wrong. That it's that the majority of global humanity prefers sin, prefers Satan. Have you noticed when you go around the city how many young people walk past you now with like pentagrams and things tattooed on them? Overtly satanic stuff. I've never seen it so bad as now. And how many young people are turning back to like things like all the old religions? Why do you think young Maori are all turning back to the pagan gods of the Maori? The people love it that way. You can't fix it with politics. It's spiritual. And because the people themselves have rejected God, you can get rid of this agent of Satan, that agent of Satan, but because the people love the evil, a new agent for that evil will simply take its place. Like a Medusa, you know, you cut off one head, it grows two more. Politics will fail. All these protests will fail because you can't write legislation against the presence of demons. You can't write legislation that fixes moral failure. You can't, with human force, fix an enemy that is superhuman. It's God's judgment. Do you understand? So you might think, oh, what's the point? You know, what the heck? Because the more you understand this, the more you will understand that we in our lifetimes, we're just going to see this get worse and worse. There might be seasons where God slows it down to reach and save a particular people, but the overall trend will be down, 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 until Antichrist comes, because the people love it that way. That's what Jeremiah finally understood. He couldn't understand why they wouldn't listen until God showed him the problem is the people. In their hearts, they prefer sin. In their hearts, they don't fear God. In their hearts, they're just about today as if this is it. And as I said with the Korean example, but you see it in your peers, your younger ones, you'll see it in people you know who only, they just live for today. You know, every Friday they're out partying. They're just about experience, you know. Isn't that the saddest thing? people who try and overdose fill themselves up on every experience they can get, like bucket listing. You know, they rush around and they try this and they try this and, you know, everything. They're still going to die. If that's it, why are you doing that if you don't believe there's anything after death? What's the point of wearing yourself out, collecting all these experiences so that when you die, they can just go and be forgotten? It's insanity, right? It's spiritual. They are blind. They can't hear you. Unless God himself brings them under the conviction of his spirit, unless God himself saves them, snaps them out of the delusion, ultimately, we can't. And if he knows that they love it so much that no matter what he does, they're never going to change, then they are doomed. They are absolutely doomed. As is this world. It says that in the scripture, this world stands condemned. It's not going to be condemned, it's condemned already. That's why it's not home. That's why he calls us out of it. We're to be, remember he says, be holy because I'm holy. What does it mean? Be separate from it. Get off the sinking ship into the lifeboat. Not physically, because we're the witnesses who have to be still here, but you mustn't be part of it. Remember he says, I'm sending you as lambs amongst wolves. He prays to the Father in John 17. He says, I do not ask you to take them from here, but rather to protect them in it. They are not of this world. They are only in it, right? Separate. But for most of the people around us, that's not the description. The description of most of the people around us is wicked, and they love it that way. So as 2 Thessalonians 2 tells us, God in the end is going to give them what they want. He's going to hand them over to what their sinful natures desire. He's going to give them a ruler that suits their evil nature, Antichrist. They will love him. The wicked will love Antichrist. They will celebrate his coming. They will willingly queue up to receive the mark. He will be the rock star of rock stars in their world, because they are just like him. God gives them a delusion and he causes them to believe it. And there's, when it gets to that stage, nothing can save them after that. They are literally beyond saving at that point. It's inevitable, and that's, I guess, the bit I want you to understand. It is inevitable. This brings us to our 1 Peter 2 scripture, but that's our essential background to have all that. And just right at the bottom of page 3, you see that reminder from Matthew 26. Jesus is not leading a rebellion. Not leading a rebellion. Here's our 1 Peter 2 scripture on page 4. Dear friends, I urge you as foreigners and exiles. What are you? Foreigners and exiles. From where? This world. You live as a foreigner. Well, most of you, all the Filipinos here know what it is to live in New Zealand as a Filipino. Does that stop you living here? No, but it's different than if you were born here, right? That's what he's saying. The world is not your natural home. You live in it, you function in it, but you're not from it. You're not of it. Does that make sense? So you're here, but you're not the same. That's what he's trying to impress on them. He says, he tells them to abstain from sinful desires which wage war against your soul. First instruction, live such good lives amongst the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day he visits us. Submit yourselves for the Lord's sake to every human authority, whether to the emperor as the supreme authority or to governors who are sent by him to punish those who do wrong and to commend those who do right. For it is God's will that by doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. Show proper respect to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. So the first thing to point out there is verse 13. Submit yourself for the Lord's sake to every human authority. How many is every? Is there an exception to every? All, right? All. But during COVID, an example I said, you got all these Christian people trying to debate that surely there's some exception. Because this would have us submit to Jacinda Ardern and her demonic government and obey the laws that they made. What did Jesus say? I'm not leading a rebellion. Those that created a rebellion, remember the big protest in the park? What's the lasting impression on New Zealand of that protest? Anything positive? Even if they were telling the truth, especially the Christians that were there, what did the world take away from it though? Nothing good. Just that they were in rebellion. They set fire to things, you know? That's what Jesus is forbidding. He says, I'm not leading a rebellion. If I needed to overthrow the government, I'd just blow on them and they're gone. That wicked government was here as judgment on this country. And that judgment has continued, just like in the States. Every means every. There's no exception. Which we see our next scripture, Romans 13, makes even clearer. Romans 13, verse 1. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities. Why? For there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted. And those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. So people immediately start screaming, but God is good. God can't be the author of, you know, the crazy lefties or the immoral this or, you know, all that evil. God can't be the author of that. He can't do evil. Who's doing the evil? Pick on Jacinda Ardern because she's gone, right? So think of the Ardern government, all the anti-Christian stuff they did. Who did that? God? No, them. They did the evil. God sent them. God never does evil. How could God require New Zealand to have that government and call it good? How can that evil government serve God's purpose? What did it straight away do? It made every Christian get real when they realized that they had a demonic government. Complacency went out the door. It's tribulation. If you don't think God uses evil for good purpose, what did he do when he couldn't get the 10 northern tribes to repent, no matter how many prophets he sent them? What did he do? He sent Assyria. Was Assyria godly and nice and pleasant? How about when Judah wouldn't obey? What did he do? He sent Babylon. Were the Babylonians like the absolute picture of Christianity? God has always used purely evil, demonic regimes, organizations, and people as agencies of change and of judgment to avenge himself against the wicked and to force the lukewarm off the fence. To either leave me completely or get real. But I will not allow you to stay lukewarm. It people saying, this is causing division, as if that was a bad thing. Who do you think was causing the division? God. What was he doing? He's separating the wheat from the chaff. He's separating the cold from the hot. And he was forcing the lukewarm to separate into cold and hot. The division you saw happening is God's purpose in sending such evil things that you couldn't stop. You couldn't pray against it. Why? Because it had God's authority to be there. Remember Hananiah saying to the people in Babylon, to the Jews in Babylon, oh, God, we'll get rid of the Assyrian. Next year we'll be back in Jerusalem, blah, blah, blah. What did Jeremiah tell them? No. God said 70 years, because you would not repent, because you did not obey, now Babylon has come. For you, it's 70 years. You can't fix it. The 70 years will be completed. He says, so settle down. What else did he say in Jeremiah 29? Settle down, build houses, get married, have children, increase, don't decrease. Pray for that city, because if it prospers, you will prosper in it. God did not take that wickedness away. He used it to bring a rebellious people to repentance. So that 70 years later, when their children returned to Israel, they were repenting. They were not just returning to Jerusalem, they were returning to God. This is such an important, even Antichrist himself is sent by God. 2 Thessalonians tells us that. God sends him. God sends the delusion. Antichrist is the most evil thing that will ever be on the planet, and yet it is sent by God for God's righteous purpose. God is sovereign at all times. But as I was saying before we got into Peter, what's the human reaction? What's the church reaction? We have to stop it. We have to get political. We have to go on a rally. We have to burn something down. You know, we have to chop someone's ear off. Or God forbid you get these crazy ultra-right-wing Americans that blend Christianity and being a patriotic American together, and you end up with the Ku Klux Klan and things like that, right? Who'll go around lynching anyone they don't like and murdering people and blowing their houses up in the name of God. It's evil. It's the opposite of what Jeremiah tells us to do. We have to recognize that God has appointed every authority for his purpose, even the ones we don't like, even Antichrist. Every authority. And we're told that we are to submit to those authorities. We have to submit. So right at the bottom of page 4, we just break that down. He says, I urge you as foreigners and exiles to abstain from sinful desires. So I see in the red there, it says, so you are in the world, not of it, if you are his. So don't be surprised when it treats you like an unwanted visitor, because you make the world uncomfortable when you refuse to join in the city, in the sinning. You have free will. Resist the devil and he'll flee from you. Walk in Christ's instruction and he'll be right there in you, and every demon will know it. The only protection from Satan in those days will be in Christ. If you're already sealed in Christ, Satan can't seal you for himself. People say, oh, how can I avoid getting I don't want to get the mark of the beast. Well, you have to be a real disciple, because everybody else will be marked. How come? Well, God will make sure they're marked. It's that delusion. He causes them to believe it. They'll queue up for the mark. Right? The only defense is to really be in Christ. But if you're in Christ, some demon comes to trouble you. What does the demon see first of all? He sees who's with you. Right? Remember when that deliverance ministry in the first century saw that the apostles, everyone was going to the apostles because they could really cast out demons? And he was just a Jewish rabbi, right? He didn't believe in Jesus. So he tried casting out demons because he charged money for it. He was making money. So his way was to shout at the demon-possessed person. And he said, in the name of Jesus that Paul preaches, come out from this person. What was the demon's response? Does anyone remember that bit of scripture? That's right. Paul we know. Jesus we know. But who are you? Right? You can't deal with demons unless you are in Christ. The demon will never be scared of you. The demon will never do anything but mock you on your own. But if Christ is in you and with you in the person of the Holy Spirit, that's a whole different ball game. Paul we know, Jesus we know, but who are you? Remember that. And they set upon them and beat that guy out, if you remember how that story goes. Number two, live such good lives amongst the pagans that though they accuse you of doing wrong, they may see your good deeds and glorify God on the day when he visits. Then in verse 15 it says, for it is God's will that in doing good you should silence the ignorant talk of foolish people. Live as free people, but do not use your freedom as a cover-up for evil. Live as God's slaves. You sum it up like this. We have to be among them. You should live as if your free will wasn't there. You should make yourself a slave to the commands of God, a slave to Jesus' example. Why? Because of who's watching you. You don't know who's going to be saved, the people God has you with, among. You don't know whether it's that guy sitting in the truck next to you. You don't know. And if you only be Christian amongst your Christian friends, you are disobeying this. We have to be Christian because being Christian is the right thing. We should live as he commanded, because it's the right thing, impartial to who's watching. And you don't know which of those people God may be speaking to at that very time. Why do we have to still be among them? If you go back to parts 13 and 14, where we talked about the process of salvation, remember it starts with conviction, right? Of their sin, his righteousness, and the consequences. If they submit, if they ask God to save them, if they decide to be Christian, that starts the process, but they need someone to explain to them what's happening. They need someone. Remember when Jesus raises Lazarus, he says to the disciples, you unwrap him from the grave. You take the grave clothes off him and dress him again. That's our job. That's why we're still here in the tribulation. God has to have his witnesses where the people he's trying to reach are. So that's what he's saying to us here. Resist the temptation to just cave in and join in with the wicked world, because that'll be tempting. It's easier to just go along, right? It's easier at your office or your workplace or whatever, or your school, to just fit in. He says, don't fit in. What you're fitting into is going to hell. What you're fitting into is going to be destroyed. You've been bought out, stay out. But since God has you physically there, be the one who's different. I always say, be the Christian. Don't go out evangelizing. You know, I hate that. I hate it when people who are one thing at home and then they go, oh, we should go evangelizing today, and then they turn into some other person, put their evangelizing hat on and go out. Everyone can tell it's fake. The only evangelizing that really works is that every time they meet you, you are really different. The only way you'll have credibility is when every time they meet you, you're not a hypocrite. They're looking for hypocrites. That's what this is saying. Resist the temptation to fall into step with what's evil. Now, Number three, this you have to, we have to put our Greek hats on now. Show proper respect. So from back in our scripture, this is verse 17. Show proper respect to everyone. So to everyone. Love the family of believers. Fear God. Honor the emperor. So to everyone, show respect. To the family of believers, love. To God, fear. And to the emperor, representing secular authority, honor. So this word honor, timeo, that means to give value to recognize weight. And we have to do that to everyone. What does that reflect? That reflects God's impartiality. You don't get to choose who to honor. You don't get to choose and say, oh, this person's worth of my time, but this person isn't. He says, honor, give weight to everyone because God is impartial. We're really good at thinking that we can decide which ones to pray for and which ones to witness to. No. Honor everyone. Everyone. The next one, it says concerning other Christians, the word is agapeo, love. Love the family of God. By now you all know what's special about that. Agape, right? It's the love that's associated with obeying God. It's not to do with feelings. So for the family of Christ, we are commanded to agape. Why does he emphasize this for the family of Christ? So honor everyone, whether they're Christian or not. In other words, treat them that for God they have value. There's no worthless people. This agape is especially important for the body of Christ. Why? Especially in the last days, Satan will try and isolate us. They'll try and get you to isolate. You watch. Guarantee it. Satan will try and get you to stop fellowshipping and think that you're safer by yourself and I'll just stay home and I'll just hide in my bed, etc., etc. It's always Satan that tries to separate a sheep out from the flock, where he can swallow you. We are commanded not to give up fellowship because sheep on their own are easy meat. Focusing on agape for the rest of the body of Christ means we act as shepherds towards all the other sheep. If one is starting to not turn up for church, we have to go find them. We have to find out what's going on. We have to protect them. Because Satan will try and scatter us for living certain, right? So there's this emphasis that we must agape, that's the character of the shepherd, Jesus, especially the other believers, right? So we need to agape everyone, but especially the other believers. As I say, Satan doesn't waste ammunition on those who are already dead. You know, Satan largely doesn't bother the wicked. He's already got them. He spends his time trying to add us to the list. Then it says, fear God, right? This word here is phobia, from where you get the word phobia. You familiar with that word, a phobia? It means like something that causes you panic. That means this in Greek as well. So it's not being slightly afraid, it means terrified. Phobia means to be terrified. So we're instructed to be terrified of God. Why? Isn't he loving and kind? Yeah, but be terrified of him. Why? Because it's not a drill. Remember what God said about the lukewarm? That's the problem with them. They have no fear of him. They don't take it seriously. They don't realize that what's happening is not a drill. That has eternal consequences. So why does God want you to be terrified of him? For your own sake. It's a life jacket against drowning in complacency. Drowning in a delusion that, oh yeah, but it'll be fine. Nothing will happen. I'll be fine. No, you won't. By the time you realise you're drowning, the lifeboat could be too far to swim to. fear God. It keeps you real. It keeps you real. I've said here, embrace God's scary side as a life preserver when you are tempted to buckle and go along with sin just to keep the peace or to stop people treating you as weird. It's not weird to want eternal peace. It's not weird to want eternal life. It's only weird to reject it. If people treat you as weird, you are not the weird one. What you are desiring as a Christian is sanity. To reject it, that's weird. Fear God and remember we're not the weird ones. And the last one, again, honour, that same word, timeo, means to give weight to the emperor, even Antichrist. It means we are not to take them lightly. They are appointed by God. Even if they're evil, even if they're nuts, even like completely nuts, they are appointed, they're there for God's purpose. We are not to dismiss them as meaningless. So if they make laws, they are laws made by something God appointed. Something God appointed. We are, and number four there, I just reminded you from Romans 13, that whoever ignores this brings judgment on themselves. If you rebel against the authority that God has instituted, you're rebelling against God. It's what honour the emperor means. Honour the fact that they are there at God's will. So now the question, if we're doing all this, and there's no exceptions, every human authority, that's what Peter says, obey every human authority. Is there another authority that you don't have to obey? I'll say it again, every human authority you must submit. But is there another authority that you should never obey? Satan, the powers and the principalities that are your real enemy. And we're going to finish in the book of Daniel, looking at the practical example of what this means. Where is this line? How do you draw the line, right? So let's just say we had a completely off-the-wall government. Oh, okay, we do all the time. But they suddenly made a rule that from now on, everyone in New Zealand must only wear blue or go to jail. What should you do? According to this, what should you do? Wear blue. Why? Jesus said, I'm not leading a rebellion. If you just go and burn houses down or march in the street or beat somebody up because you don't like the idea of being told you have to wear blue, the only witness you will have is rebels. Whatever message else you try and say will be completely cancelled and lost because you'll only be seen as rebels. So just suck it up and wear blue. Because wearing blue will have no impact on your salvation. None. Right? But what if that government says you must all convert to Islam? Or worse, you must all, let's say it's Jacinda again, and since the whole world press already did it, what if the government passed a law that says you have to agree with the world press and you have to deify Jacinda and you have to worship her as the only true God? Now what? What changed? Because obviously you're going to say, no way, we're not going to do that. What's different? The difference is, the first is only an earthly authority. The second is spiritual. The second is something trying to take the place of God who appointed that authority. If you just agree to wear blue, you're obeying God. But if you agree to worship only Jacinda Ardern instead of Jesus, it's God you're disobeying. That is the bright line. Until they ask you to reject Jesus, you just comply. It doesn't matter. It's incidental. But when they ask you to bow, bend the knee, to worship something as God that isn't, that is God's bright line. And we will see that here in Daniel. So we know that Babylon the Great is coming, right? That's the kingdom of Antichrist. But we already have another Babylon. Babylon the practice run. Back in the time of Jeremiah, right? So everything that God did in Babylon tells us something about how it will be for his people under Antichrist in Babylon the Great. So Antichrist there is represented by Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, right? Who are the main players for our team in that scene? Who's the most principal one? Daniel. And he's got three mates. Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. Right? Daniel is Hebrew. He has a Babylonian name as well, which we can ignore. Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, they're Babylonian names. All those three guys have Hebrew names. We're going to look at them now because they are our role model for how to handle this instruction in 1 Peter 2. Where is the bright line? When do we stop submitting and say no? So Daniel, his name means God is my judge. Remember what Paul says? Fear God, honour the emperor as God's tool for God's purpose. Do right because it's right, even if people laugh or mock. Because why? Because only one judge watching you will matter in the end. Be Daniel. Be someone who understands there's just one judge. God. Live to please him, even if other people laugh. God is my judge. Shadrach, his Hebrew name is Hananiah, which means God has been gracious, generous. God is with them to do good. He's proactive in this because salvation is a gift from him. God is proactive in his salvation for them. Hananiah, God has been gracious. Meshach, his Hebrew name is Mishael. Mishael. It means who is what God is. Who is what God is? What's the answer to that? You're all Christians, so you know. Who is what God is? It's Messiah. It's Jesus. He is, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right? Mishael, his name, is about God revealing his nature through a man. So we have God is the only judge. God is gracious. He is able to show himself. The last one. Where are we? Abednego, his Hebrew name is Azariah, which means God has helped us. God has helped. He's the only judge. He is gracious. He is able to reveal himself through his people. He has helped. He is not an indifferent observer. So these four guys create like a little mini body of Christ, if you like, under Daniel. God chooses these men and he puts them in Babylon and he reveals himself to Nebuchadnezzar. If you read the book of Daniel, the most striking thing is no matter what happens, Nebuchadnezzar always has the same response. When Nebuchadnezzar was tricked by his court officials into signing a law that then meant he had to throw those three into the brick furnace to burn them alive, what happened? He threw Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego, who represent God is gracious, God is able to reveal himself, and God has helped us. So those three together, those are the three things that God, by giving them that name, God is going to demonstrate. What happened in the brick furnace? When Nebuchadnezzar looked in the brick furnace to see the three men burning, what did he see? Four. And are they burning? No. It couldn't have been me because they were dancing. Right? They're dancing. They're not burning. They're not screaming. They're dancing. Who's the fourth guy? It's not hard. Who's the fourth guy in the furnace? It's an Old Testament appearance of Jesus. He's gracious, meaning he wants to save. He is able to reveal himself. He's literally revealed in the furnace with them. And he has helped. He has saved them. When they come out of the furnace, what does Nebuchadnezzar do? You can look this up at home. What does Nebuchadnezzar do? He falls on his face and he worships the God of Daniel. He's terrified of the God of Daniel because he knows his tin pot God can never do that. So the witness, so they're in the furnace, but their faithful witness caused God's faithful witness. And the wicked one was forced to his knees to acknowledge that your God is God. That's us in the tribulation. Did they have any choice about being in the furnace? Yeah, they could have bowed the knee. So up to that point, who are these four men? They are smart Jews. They are cleverer than the Babylonians, which is why God has them appointed as the most important advisors to Nebuchadnezzar. Under their advice, Babylon prospers. Remember what Jeremiah said? And it says in the book of Daniel that Daniel carefully studied the scroll of Jeremiah. He understood Jeremiah 29, put it into action. So they're in Babylon, but they're prospering. They obey the king. They help the king in every secular thing. But when he tells them that they have to bow the knee to this foreign god, look what it says in Daniel 3 at the bottom there. Well, it's almost at the bottom. So this is when they're told they're going to have to bow the knee to Babylon's false god. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego replied to him, King Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves before you in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. And he will deliver us from your majesty's hand. But even if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up. You see where they draw the line? They served them to the prosperity of Babylon. So long as it didn't cross the line into disobeying God, they understood they were serving God's purpose by being faithful, obedient, non-rebellious, doing what Jeremiah said. Settle down, build houses, get married, increase, don't decrease. You know? Because you don't have any choice about being in Babylon, just as we won't have any choice about being in tribulation. It's global. We'll be no, you can't do a geographical and go somewhere where it's not. Be everywhere, right? So you won't have any choice, but you have a choice whether you're going to be a Daniel, a Meshach, a Shadrach, or a Abednego, or a rebel. The rebels perish. Read Jeremiah 28 and 29 to see what happened to Hananiah, the false prophet, who was counseling rebellion, right? There's your bright line. So when they said you have to get a vaccine to keep your job, have they asked you to serve a foreign god? Have they asked you to stop being Christian? So when I say it has nothing to do with your salvation, that's why. If you just overtly rebel, if you go and make a big song and dance and burn Parliament down or something or other and say, well, we're Christian, we have to do this, false. No. That will slander God. Remember, he says, I am not leading a rebellion. It's when they cross the line and tell you that you can't be Christian. That's when, notice what they said, we do not have to defend ourselves before you in this matter. What do they mean? Remember Daniel's name? Daniel's not here, but he's watching, right? What does Daniel's name mean? God is my judge. That's what they're saying to Nebuchadnezzar. You're just the king that God has appointed for his purpose, but you're not God. You are a tool in our God's hand, but you yourself are not God. It is to him we serve you because we are to honor the emperor. So, and so long as you don't ask us to change gods, we will obey our God in serving and honoring you, even if you want stupid stuff. But if you cross the line, we do not have to give account to you because we've never been actually working for you. We're working for our God concerning you. And if you now require us to change gods, now you're out on your own. See where the bright line is? Now you're on your own. It says, and if you try and kill us, our God is able to save us. So if you're into the triumphalist Christian thing, that's it, right? Jesus is greater than all. He can save me, blah, 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 blah. But Revelations tells us that many will be martyred. What, was Jesus on holiday that day? Was he busy elsewhere and he didn't get around to saving you? The scripture tells us that many will be martyred. That's why what they say next is important. But even if he does not save me, they mean in the physical sense. Even if they had burned up in the fire, says, even then we will not worship another God. And remember how we started, because we're going to finish now. Remember how we started saying the human instinct is to try and stop it? But you can't let them be burned in the fire. Surely God will save them. Surely. No, surely. It could be part of the witness. Nothing's more powerful than a martyr. No one's remembered. What about Stephen in the book of Acts? Did Jesus stop him being stoned to death? No. Instead, he showed Stephen that, now, come up. You're going home early. You'll see I've put there in Luke 12, our last bit of scripture. Luke 12, verse 4, this is Jesus talking. He says, I tell you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who can kill the body, but after that, can't do anything more. But I'll show you whom you should fear. Fear him who, after your body has been killed, has authority to throw you into hell. Yes, I tell you, fear him. That's Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego in a nutshell. They understood that even if their body, their temporary tent they live in, even if their earthly life was coming to an end, it just meant going home early. That Nebuchadnezzar had no authority over their soul. That the fate of their soul, the fate of their essential being in eternity, was in the hands of only one, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. And that's why they says, kill me if you want to. God is able to save me, but even if he doesn't, meaning even if you actually kill my body, even then, I won't agree to betray my God to serve yours. Because why? Because you and your God can do nothing more than kill my body, but my God My God determines the fate, the eternal fate of all things. So go ahead and kill me, send me home early if you must. I might even thank you. You know, hee, out of here. Awesome. Remember what Paul said in the last where he says, to die is to gain. But the reason I stay is for your sake. That's what Paul was saying. That's Meshach, Shadrach, and Abednego. The key of it is you have to understand this is not home. This world, this life is just on the way. Home is to be back with God. Home is to ascend with him, where Jesus ascended to ascend with him. You die with him in order to ascend with him. To do that, you have to be crucified with him. To take up your life, live a crucified life. Stop catering to your stomach. Stop thinking that the here and the now is the important thing. Even if you die physically, and some, you know, don't assume that Jesus should save you. You don't know what he's saving you from by having you die early. If you knew what was coming, you wouldn't be in such a hurry to live a long time. You understand? But we leave the times to God, the means to God, the storyline to God. He is the author and perfecter of our faith, and what he has begun, he's faithful to finish. The only bit we have any control over, and this is the only part where living in the present has any value, is that in every moment of every day, you have free will to choose what you do next. Every situation, you have free will to choose what you do next. Choose this day whom you will serve. As for me, hopefully my house, we will serve the living God. And there we finish. So there's a little bit more in here. You can glean, but it's all easy stuff. If you read it, to fill in the blanks, the things I skipped over. But nothing that will tax you to understand. So Father, we thank you, we bless you, we pray, Lord, that we pray, Lord, that we never end up in any brick furnace. But if we do, Lord, we pray and ask that you would be in it with us, that you would strengthen us and give us the power to testify, so that the unsaved would see it, Lord, and fall on their faces and acknowledge you and be saved themselves. Help us to stand, Lord, in the days that are coming. Set us apart for yourself, together with as many as can be saved. I thank you for this morning's prayer, Lord, in the shower. Lord, that you yourself loved those people, loved us, and loved the people we are yet even to meet, Lord, before we knew they existed, and regardless of what they are like now. You have seen them who they will be when you turn to save them. For that we give thanks, even for our own lives. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen, and till next time, shalom.